So what is that thixotropy? Thixotropy is defined as isothermal and comparatively slow recovery on standing of a material of a consistency lost through shearing. Just remember that. So dispersion medium is largely responsible for determining the rheology of suspensions. The pre-formulation studies also include evaluation of vehicles used in the suspension, and optimum viscosity of this medium should be selected throughout the experimentations. The experimental methods which involved the study of system from lower to higher rate of shear, the resultant thixotropic curve which are compared with those of standard product. From that figure, see that when the concentrations of solid, that is different, it will show different types of flow properties. For example, 50% CMC and 50% of microbentonite. Next, in cases of 5% Vigam, next 5% microbentonite. So see that 5% and 50%. So where the viscosity, that will completely change, so that the flow property, that will be also changed. It may shows dilatant flow or plastic flow, and if the solid content is very much less, in that cases it will shows Newtonian flow. So the flow behavior in the above curves indicates that the combination of 5% CMC and 5% microbentonite, that is more suitable vehicle when compared to individual suspending agent. So from that figure we can say that combination of 5% CMC and 5% microbentonite, that is that combination, that is more suitable vehicle when compared to individual suspending agent. See that in cases of 5% microbentonite, the flow curve, and in cases of combination, what is the flow curve. So this rheological evaluation, that is used as a quality control parameter for comparing the different types of suspension. The consistency of suspensions are evaluated using cup and bob or cone and plate viscometer. Now what is cup and bob, what is cone and plate viscometer, you have studied in rheology chapter. These are not applicable for flocculated suspension because the structure of flocs are destroyed during the analysis. So this is all about suspensions. Now for determination of viscosity of suspension, we can use Brookfield viscometer. So what is that? In industrial purpose, this type of Brookfield viscometer, that is used. These instruments may be ideal to study the behavior of settling. It is mounted on helipath stand with a T spindle. The T bar rotates and changes its position continuously. At the same time, it also descends slowly into the suspension with the help of synchronous motor. The path traced by the spindle, that is a helix. As the T bar moves, the sediment offers resistance. So the dial loading indicates the magnitude of resistance. Thus, using that different types of spindle and helipath, the dial reading can be plotted against the number of turns of spindle. So from that figure we can see that different types of spindle and what is the structure of Brookfield viscometer. Since the T were continuously encountered the undisturbed layer, the results indicate how the particles are settling with respect to time. As T were continuously descend newer layer of suspension, this technique provides information about the level at which the flocs network is greater due to aggregations. The effect of aging and storage condition, that can also be evaluated by this method, because if the storage property or storage condition is not proper, and if the aging is, or if any formulation that is already expired, so in that cases also we can evaluate that product by the help of this Brookfield viscometer. In the screening study, good suspension shows a lesser rate of increase of dial loading as the spindle turns. The curve is horizontal for a longer period of time. Next, last part, that is rheological properties of emulsion. Now the rheological properties of emulsion, why it is required, that already in the introduction part already I told. Emulsions are evaluated for its flow behavior. The following flow related attributes which are desirable for the overall performance of an emulsion. So what is that? First one is removal of an emulsion from a bottle or tube. Second part, flow of an emulsion through a hypodermic needle in cases of injection. The flowability of emulsion product, that should be syringeability should be there, otherwise it will not possible to give an injection in the form of emulsion. So spreadability in cases of semi-solid product, which are types of emulsion, for example cream or ointment. If it is emulsion, we know that cream, that means that is one emulsion. So spreadability, that also an important factor on which the performance of that particular product depends on. So spreadability is another one important factor. And fourth one, that is stress induced flow changes during the manufacturing process, because during manufacturing process so many factors are there. So whatever stress that is applied during the manufacturing process, that stress induced flow changes during the manufacture, that is another one factor on which rheological properties of emulsion depends on. The rheology of emulsion has many similar features, so that the same like suspension, however they differ in three main aspect. So what is that three aspect? The liquid-liquid interface that contains surfactant or polymer layer introduce a response to deformation, and one has to consider the interfacial rheology. This part that is related with mechanism of emulsifying agent. In my last lecture already we have discussed about that, the mechanism of emulsifying agent, how they will adsorb on the liquid-liquid interface. Already we have seen there the first mechanism. Just remember, three mechanisms are there. First one, monomolecular film formation. Yes, so the dispersed phase viscosity relative to that of the medium, that is another one effect on the rheology of the emulsion. That means the viscosity of aqueous phase and viscosity of oil phase, both are important. Not only viscosity, density also, that is another one factor on which the rheology of one particular emulsion depends on. The deformable nature of dispersed phase droplet, particularly for large droplet, has an effect on the emulsion rheology. In general, the dilute emulsion exhibit Newtonian flow like suspension. As the viscosity of the emulsion increases, flocculation of globules will be reduced because the mobility of globules is restricted. Why? Because which leads to creaming. Due to this antagonistic effect, an optimum viscosity is desirable for a good stability. So concentrated emulsion, it shows non-Newtonian flow. So in that cases, multi-point viscometer that can be used for determination of viscosity. Multi-point viscometer, example Brookfield viscometer. Last one, that is rheological properties of semi-solid. Viscosity of semi-solid dosage form that may directly influence the diffusion rate of the drug. Therefore, the product behavior must be monitored at the time of application. This also helps to monitor batch-to-batch consistency, because when that are stored in a tube, so how much pressure should be applied, then only the product that will come out from that bottle, that is one important factor. So for semi-solid product, for example cream, ointment, the rheological properties is very much important, because any cream, suspension, cream, gel, jelly, all this type of product, it shows plastic viscosity. In rheology chapter, different types of examples that we have seen. So rheological properties of semi-solid, that also one important factor. Most topical semi-solid, topical means which are applied on the skin. When applied on the surface of the skin, so non-Newtonian behavior. The structure formed within semi-solid drug products during manufacturing can show a wide range of behavior, including thixotropy and irreversible or reversible structure damage. A number of rheological properties play an important role in determining how a material behaves as it moves from storage to handling environment. For example, the force or stress required to initiate flow of semi-solid product plays a significant role in the shelf life of the product, storage of the product, transfer, packaging, and end-use performance of this material. So, From this, what we can say finally, conclusion, that rheological properties for colloidal dispersion as well as coarse dispersion, that means suspension emulsion, as well as different types of semi-solid product, is very much important factor during the use as well as storage, as well as the stability of the, to get the better stability of that product. Semi-solid do not flow at lower shear stress, but it undergoes reversible deformation like elastic solid. When a characteristic shear stress is exceeded, they flow like liquid. In cases of plastic viscosity, just remember that rheogram, the minimum energy that is required to flow of that particular material. What is that value? That value is known as yield value. So semi-solid with high yield value, that are described as hard. When their plastic viscosity is high, they are described as stiff material. Best instrument for determining the rheological properties of pharmaceutical semi-solid is rotational viscometer. For example, cone and plate, cup and bob, and Brookfield viscometer. Next part is method of preparations of emulsion. Commercially, emulsions are prepared in large volume mixing tank and refined and stabilized by passage through a colloidal mill or homogenizer. So by using in industrial level, by using homogenizer, we can prepare the emulsions. Different types of methods are there for preparations of emulsion. Here we can see the list, the different types of method of preparations of emulsion. In industrial pharmacy subject also you have studied, and in first semester pharmaceutical subject already you have studied this method. So we will continue this details about the different types of method that is followed for preparations of emulsion, that we will discuss in next class. Thank you.